Okay, so what we'll do today is entirely kind of programming based, and tomorrow in the lab hopefully we'll do some practical with it. Since we were discussing threads, first thing we'll cover is programming with threads on Linux. So there's actually a potential source of confusion. So if you are looking at material on the net, then be careful what date the material was written on. I think up to mid-2004 or 2005, the implementation of threads in Linux was something called, obviously enough, Linux threads. But that had some problems. So after that, they changed to something called NPTEL or some such. So is the name POSIX familiar with you? So POSIX is basically a standard. Standard meaning like we use open close read write system calls, then fork, exec. So system calls like that. I think what was the problem was that you had different variants of Unix like operating systems, and then there were some differences in the calling convention for these system calls. So to kind of improve portability of code across these different variants of Unix, some people got together and formulated this POSIX standard. So the POSIX standard defines that certain function calls have to behave in a certain way. They have to take certain arguments in certain order. Their return value will be this. So the standard specifies those things. Basically now operating systems can, I mean, depending on whether they conform to the POSIX standard, they can say they are POSIX compliant or not. So I think original Linux threads was not POSIX compliant. So the newer implementation, I forget what the N stands for, but the P stands for POSIX, and I think the TL probably stands for thread library. So the newer implementation is more or less POSIX compliant. So which is why I said, I mean, if you're looking at documentation or discussions on the net, make sure that they are reasonably recent. Otherwise, you will be looking up material on the old, outdated Linux threads. Okay, so very quickly, I mean, already threads we've discussed in the abstract. So we already know what are kind of common to all threads and what is thread specific. So in the context of programming, I think the additional things that you want to keep in mind is open files and current working directory shared across all files, shared across all threads, and the thread specific resources, thread ID, register, stack, this we have already talked about. Scheduling information is thread specific, and this we talked about last time, remember thread local storage. Because error number is a global variable that is used by the kernel to signal error codes, and different threads make different system calls. So error number is also thread specific. Okay, one word about the implementation. Basically, I mean, remember we talked about kernel threads, lightweight processes, and user threads. So kernel threads, remember, are not visible to us as programmers. So it will only be lightweight processes, which we are calling the intermediate thread, intermediate level, and user level threads. So the threads that we are dealing with here, they are basically LWPs. So each of the threads that we talk about in this tutorial, they are all bound to one kernel thread, which is basically why it is possible to define different priorities for different threads. I mean, the kernel sees each kernel thread as a schedulable entity, and because each programming thread is bound to one kernel thread, you can have different priorities for different threads. Okay, so actual function calls that you will require, really not visible, but anyway, I'll put this up on the website anyway. So in order to create a thread, you have to call pthread create. So these are the arguments, four things basically. And this, I think, we have briefly discussed in an earlier class. So first thing you do is an address to the thread ID. So officially, this is of type pthread underscore t, and that is how you should declare it. But this is really an unsigned long integer. So you have a, one kind of point that we have discussed, but is significant from a programming point of view, is that all local variables are only visible to threads. So if you want something to be visible across threads, then you have to make sure that it is global. So when you pass an address over here, I mean, notice this is a pointer, so you will have to define a variable of type pthread underscore t, and then do ampersand thread ID. So if you want other threads, including in particular the default thread or main, which runs at startup, if you want them to access this thread, then you have to make sure that this is a global variable. Or at least, I mean, if you create the thread inside main and main is the only function that refers to this, then it is all right to make it a local variable to main. Okay, what else? So main thing is address of the where it will store the thread ID, what function to execute inside the thread, and its arguments. Now, basically, because this is, I think we are also briefly discussed earlier, is that the function you want to execute within the thread, that might take arbitrary number of arguments. So it is not possible to pass all of that here. So the way out is the only single argument that a function that you want to run inside a thread, it can only take a void star. So if you want to pass 3, 4, whatever many arguments, put them in a structure and pass a pointer to that structure and cast it to void before passing. So inside the function, first you will have to unpack that structure, I mean, cast it back from void star to pointer to structure type and access the field, set up the parameters, then proceed with whatever work needs to be done. This middle argument that I skipped, this is something called thread attribute. So I think for our purposes, we will probably not need to kind of interfere with the defaults. So second argument, if you just pass a null pointer, then it will take the default attributes. And I think for the programs that we will write, that will probably be good enough. Okay, so whenever you want to create a thread from the calling function, say to start with main, inside main you will call pthread create. So when does this finish? Several possible ways. One is, I mean, basically think of the analogy that we started the discussion on threads with, that threads are basically like sub-processes within a process. So how does a process terminate? Basically, when you finish, normally what happens is when you finish main and you execute the return from main, the program finishes. So here, this is basically like your the start routine, that is basically like the main for your thread. So when you finish, or when the thread finishes executing this routine and executes the return statement from whatever function name you have given here, then the thread will terminate. Other possibilities are, so that is normal exit from a process. Likewise, here you return from the calling of the function that you're executing in the thread, you finish. Other possibility is, suppose you encounter an error. What would you do in a process? You'd call exit. So in a thread, you actually have two possibilities. You can call the direct exit system call, except that exit is used for process termination. So if from any one thread you call exit system call, all threads will be destroyed. I mean, the whole process will exit. So usually that is not what you want. If you want to exit only that particular calling thread, you call pthread underscore exit. So normal termination we've covered. You can call pthread exit if you want, I mean, if there's some kind of error. Also, one other part of the analogy that goes over is when you exit from main or do a normal return, that return value or the exit argument, that is a kind of status that is available to the parent process. So if the parent process calls wait, it will get back the exit status. So here also, when you call pthread exit, you can pass a return value. And once again, arbitrary return values are possible. You just have to cast the address of the return value to a pointer. Last possibility is that just like you can, like say you're running a program and you type control C to kill it, you can also do that programmatically. Means that if there is a running process, you send it a signal from another process, then the receiving process usually terminates. So here also at the thread level, that is possible. You can call a function called pthread cancel. So one process will kill another, one thread will kill another thread. So for all of these, I mean, which are kind of a function like pthread cancel, where you have to identify which thread you want to cancel. Just like you need a PID to send a signal, you will need a thread ID to send a pthread cancel. So that is where this thread ID that pthread fills in, this will be useful for something like pthread cancel. Okay, so now suppose we inside main. So I'm being lazy here, but when you are actually writing programs, always make sure that you check the return value from system call. So I'm skipping that part for now, but don't do that in real programs you write. Say you give some function name over here, and maybe that just prints hello world or something. And you do the same thing for and this can be as well. Let's say, I mean, like I said, I mean, whatever is here, print some kind of a message. So you think for a minute and tell me how many threads are running in this program. And how many of you think there's one thread? Nobody, right? Okay. Two threads? Two threads or three threads? Or four threads or more?
Three.
Okay. So then now you also tell me if these are, I mean, essentially the function you are doing is something like printf hello. Both this function and this function. What do you expect to see on screen? Little more carefully. No. The answer, because the answer to the previous question was 3. No, the correct answer is up to 2 hellos. Now you think of the explanation why. So you are correct that there are 3 threads. So the 3 threads correspond to TID1, TID2, and 1 for the main. So at this point, TID1 gets created. Doesn't mean that it's going to run. So it's another thread within the program. Likewise over here. Now if the main happens to run, calls return 0 and exits before anything else, then these threads are also going to be destroyed when they, because of the exit call. So they are not actually going to get a chance to print the hello. So you'll get up to 2 hello words. I mean, depending on whether these get to work first or whether main terminates earlier. So that's usually not what you want, right? I mean, you spawn threads and then main finishes, so the program dies before, or the program exits before the other threads have done their work. So that's not a very useful programming paradigm. So the other function that we need is something like wait. So pthread join is basically like the, or is the thread equivalent of the wait system call for processes. So you think of one typical example how we or one common way that we use wait is something like this is what you are accustomed to seeing. So the shell, remember we've discussed this already, the shell forks a child process. Inside the child process it does an ls. That child process will print the list of files here. But if you don't do a wait in the parent, then from your earlier lab, you have seen that the prompt gets printed somewhere inside the output. So now it looks like, I mean, there's kind of no prompt. So that you have seen in your lab. So basically what we do is inside the parent shell, we call a wait. So it waits for the ls to terminate and then it prints the prompt. So same way, what we will do over here is called, so inside the main, you create the pthreads. So basically what it will do is, it will take the thread ID that it has to wait for, and it will also take a pointer to some place where it can store the return value. So this is actually the calling convention. You pass the TID and you pass some place where it can store the return value. So if you now, like after you have done the pthread create TID1 and pthread create TID2 over here, you wait for the corresponding TID1 and this can be now, we don't want any return value. Then what happens is, main after spawning the two threads If he does not have any work to do, it will wait until the first one has finished, it will wait until the second one has finished, and then terminate. So this way you know that you will get exactly two hello words. It is possible that PID 2 terminates earlier, but the first thing that the main thread will wait for is for TID 1 to terminate. And if TID 2 has already terminated, then this does not block. It will just return right away because TID has already terminated. TID 2 has already terminated.
It is waiting maximum of the time taken by
both of them? Let's see. More or less. I mean, it does this in order. I mean, these are not concurrent operations. So it will wait for TID first. So effectively, it's kind of maximum of the two plus a little bit, in the sense that suppose TID 2 finishes first and TID finishes later, so this waits until TID 1 finishes. This will still get called, but it will see that TID 2 has already terminated. So there's no, effectively there's no wait involved here. There'll just be a little cleanup to see if there's any return value copied back, things like that. But these are, I mean, important to note that these are kind of sequential operations. Okay. Other useful thing to know is, I mean, this we've already seen, like the exit call for processes, you have prepared exit. Whatever return you need to pass it back over here. And it's a little, I mean, you have to be careful. Remember we talked about dangling pointers earlier, where you pass a pointer to a local variable, and then we said that when you return from a function, then that stack record gets reallocated. So you shouldn't be passing a pointer to a local variable. So the same way here also, because your return value is going to be passed via a pointer, don't give an address of a local variable. Make sure it is, because that local variable, remember, will be destroyed along with the thread. So you should pass something from either the heap or address of a global variable or something like that. Okay, last thing that we've kind of talked about during the general discussion on threads is that whenever multiple threads are working on shared data or global data. So basically what we argued is that global data is both kind of convenient and something that you have to be careful about. Convenient in the sense that there is no kind of complicated shared memory this that to deal with. You can directly, one thread can store something and one other thread will be able to read it. But this kind of reading-writing has to be synchronized because it's visible at all times to all threads. So then we need something like some synchronization primitive. So for that, we have, you have basically something like a semaphore, except that the interface is very simple. You have a mutex initialize, mutex lock, mutex unlock, and there is one additional thing that you may find convenient, that is, it is called mutex try lock. It's basically, you could think of it as a non-blocking lock. Normally what lock will do is, if you can lock, then it will lock and proceed. If you cannot lock, then the calling thread will block. Try lock, again, if it is unlocked, it will lock and proceed. But if the lock cannot proceed, because it is already locked, then it will return right away and it will give an error message back. I mean, it will return an error status from which you will be able to determine that the lock is already there. So, usually what happens is, if you are not careful with the way you lock, you could actually end up in some kind of a data situation. So, to avoid that, you have something called pthread try lock. So this is this bthread mutex init is for creation of threads. Again, you have kind of bthread underscore mutex, passive address. Attributes are kind of relatively complicated things that we will not need right now. Lock, try lock, and as I said, I mean this locks and proceed or locks, this will lock and proceed, or at least it will not block, but if it does not block, then it will return this. I mean it will set error number to this. So you can check if error number is EBZ, then you know that the lock did not succeed, but you can kind of try again after some time to lock the okay, so there are other functions also. For example, pthread cancel that we discussed in the abstract earlier. Pthread cancel is something that you might find useful. There are also functions to kind of change scheduling policies, scheduling parameters. But I think for the kind of at least I mean to start with the kind of programs that we will write, I think these function calls will probably be enough. But in any case, I mean this is just to tell you that these functions exist, how to use them, and more detailed description about what goes on inside, you'll have to read the man pages. So if you have time, then do that before the lab tomorrow. Otherwise, first thing in the lab tomorrow, look at the man pages for these systems. And the man pages are kind of helpful in a way, because at the end they also give you example programs where these thread library functions have been used. So you can use that as a starting point.
Sir,
huh?
So for this pthread mutex try lock, so you said this is a non-blocking system call. That's not system call, but
user-defined.
But
no, these are actually system calls. Like I said, I mean. What we are dealing with here are lightweight processes. I mean, for Linux threads, they are not user space threads. So it's actually a system call. But anyway, I mean, that was not your question. So what was your question?
Okay, so I thought that if it's a user defined, so you had said that we are not using a blocking system call. We are not using a non-blocking one because one thread won't be asked to won't schedule the next one.
Mm-hmm.
So I got confused.
Okay, no, these are all, I mean, for this implementation, NPTEL or whatever it is called, they are all kind of, each thread that you create via pthread create is actually bound to its own kernel thread. So there are other kind of more arcane cases that you can take care of there, but I don't think we'll need that. So basically what you, I think, I mean, offhand the one exercise that I can think of, and if I think of other exercises, I will mail them to you. Basically, what you should plan on doing tomorrow in the lab is write a multi-threaded downloader. So, actually, in your networks lab, did you actually do socket programming? So you know how to, I mean, given a INET address and a particular port number, you open mind, listen, things like, listen happens on the server, right? I mean, you know how to send and receive requests, okay? Oh, it says, I don't know the details of the protocol. Anyway, I'll try and find that out, because that is really not the point of, okay, let's see, let's forget about the network transport. Basically do a multi-threaded file copier. I mean, suppose I have a large file sitting somewhere on your local file system, and you, instead of doing a normal open file, read bytes one after the other and dump them locally, have this done concurrently with multiple threads. It's not anything terribly useful, but at least it will give you practice programming with threads. So that's the kind of exercise you should be doing tomorrow. As I said, I mean, if there are additional problems I think of, I'll mail them to you. Apart from threads, the other thing we were supposed to do earlier and did not is we talked about before the third chapter we talked about process synchronization and kind of the entire discussion was in terms of something like you write shared semaphore mutex and we just assume that would work. So how you actually write C programs with that kind of shared semaphores, that we never looked at. So kind of to complete the programming discussion, what we will look at next are how to kind of actually write C programs that involve semaphore operations. So here again, there's actually a slight source of confusion in the sense that traditional, meaning the old style, semaphore related system calls, they are called system 5 semaphores. I mean, this is a kind of relatively old version of Unix, came out of AT&T, and the semaphore related system calls are relatively more complicated there. So we'll cover those first. And then, as I mentioned, later on, in order to kind of unify the different variants of Unix, POSIX was established. So the next thing we'll look at are POSIX related semaphore system calls. And you'll see that, I mean, this is the system 5 semaphores are mostly for completeness. And if you ever need to write programs on an old machine, you may not actually have access to POSIX semaphores. Anything that is new, you will have POSIX semaphores and they're much easier to deal with, much more intuitive. So it's good to know both. This, as I said, mostly if you ever need to deal with operating systems that have been installed long ago and for whatever reason cannot be upgraded. Okay, so kind of the underlying data structure for a semaphore, I mean, in the theory part, we just said that a semaphore is a integer variable that you can only operate on through wait and signal. So later on when we looked at the blocking implementation, we saw that you have, apart from the counter, you also have a queue of processes. So in reality, it's a little more complicated. Of course, you have a unsigned short, so U short is for unsigned short. This is the actual semaphore value. But you also have other things. So the queue is actually internally maintained by the kernel. So the queue is not part of the same structure here. But what you do have is two additional counters. So these counters, send Z count, keeps track of the number of processes waiting for the semaphore value to become equal to 0. And same n count, z count for 0 and n count for number of processes waiting for any increment in the semaphore value. So in contrast to the semaphores that we discussed in the theory part, since we are dealing with an unsigned short here, notice that semaphore can value can never be negative. But the theoretical discussion, we were permitting negative values of the semaphore also. Okay, so think of, I mean, since we've already done the simpler interface, I mean, think of the mutex related functions that we saw for thread. So you will have something for creation, actually I think I said something wrong here, anyway let me correct that, creation, initialization, wait and, well okay, I mean this was called lock. And signal, but because signal means something else in Unix program, we won't use this. For the time being, just use unlock. But later on, we'll see that this has another name given to it, which is called post. Right. So these are kind of from a programming aspect or an intuitive level, these are the things that you want. For a thread, actually, I said something wrong. I said the pthread init is what creates the semaphore. Actually, that's not it. I mean, you just have to declare a semaphore type, and it becomes a semaphore. So the initialization is just something you call to make sure that it has the proper initial value. So system file. So creation is via the same get system call. Initialization is via something called sameCTL. And both these get done via something called semaphore. So basically what I'm saying is something like just writing shared semaphore mutex will work for the thread programming that we've discussed so far. In fact, you don't have to write shared because anything that's global is automatically shared across threads. But for processes using the System5 interface, you do have to write sameget. So how does sameget work? You specify a key value, we'll come to, I mean, this is basically something like the identifier. And what you can do is, instead of creating one semaphore at a time, sameget actually permits you to create multiple semaphores in one go. So the second argument is actually saying that this sameget, I want to create this many number of semaphores, all of which will be sitting in one head. And the last thing, the flag, this usually sets something like permission. Okay, what kind of permission? Remember, so far, I mean, earlier the mutexes that we were talking about, they are for thread level operations. Here, it is for across processes. So whether or what you want other processes to be able to do with the semaphore that you have just created, that you have to specify. Just like when you create a file, you set its permission, read, write, execute, something like that, you will also have to do over here. If you do not allow other processes to do operations on this semaphore, then, I mean, basically the semaphore is not going to be useful. Okay, again, I mean, the details of what the different flags are, and how you make sure that other processes can change this semaphore, all those details you please look up in the man page. I mean, actually when writing programs, you can consult the man pages to see how this is done. Okay, so the important thing is really this key. So this is something like a file name. Think of this as kind of vaguely analogous to creating a file where you have to, I mean, for a file you would give the path name. Here you provide a key. So files, the convenient thing is, okay, here, I mean, the key is actually just a number. Why using file names is convenient is that, see, the hierarchy, I mean, you start from the root directory, subdirectories, sub-subdirectories, files, all of that is visible. So any file has a well-defined name, and you can determine whether that file exists or not. Semaphore names are actually numbers. So if you choose, say for your key, you choose something like 12345. How do you know that some other program has not already created a semaphore called 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that's actually one of the problems with system 5 semaphores. You have to kind of take somewhat complicated steps in order to make sure that multiple processes that are using this semaphore, exactly the set of cooperating processes that you want, they should access the semaphore. No other process should access the semaphore. So that's actually a little kind of, it's not very straightforward. So what you can do is kind of, if you choose a particular, so let us discuss. I mean, suppose first point that I want you to think about is, why are we worried about making sure that a very well-defined set of processes access the semaphore? That's basically what, I mean, the whole discussion we started with, we want to write an application that involves cooperating processes. Something like, say, a reader, writer, or producer, consumer. Then both or any number of processes that make up the application, all of those programs we are writing. So all those processes, in order to synchronize their operation, they will have to access this common set of semaphores. Now, if I give kind of arbitrary permission and some other process accesses this semaphore, then I'll get incorrect operation. So which is why the name or the key value that I use is important. So kind of in order to make sure that I create a new semaphore and it didn't exist earlier, and then I have to make sure that this newly created semaphore is used by all the different processes making up my application. This is my problem. So one possibility is to use something called IPC private. So in SameGate, you can specify this as the semaphore key or the semaphore identifier. Then you don't have to worry about finding a distinct name. The kernel will automatically look at the semaphore IDs that are currently existing, and it will be guaranteed to give you back a new identifier that is not in use by any process. Fine, except, I mean, you have something like a producer process and a consumer process. If they both call SameGate and they both pass IPC private, then this creates one semaphore, this creates another semaphore, and you basically get no synchronization at all. So that defeats the purpose. So I think one effective way to use IPC private is have one process create the semaphore using IPC private, and then that kind of manager process forks, or using fork, you create, I mean, basically one, the parent and the child, maybe, happy coincidence, say the parent runs the producer and the child runs the consumer. So then what will happen is, because this was created as a child process, it will inherit most things from the parent. So including the semaphore, it will also inherit the semaphore from the parent. So this IPC private prior to the fork guarantees that you get a distinct semaphore, and the fork ensures that both parent and child share the same semaphore, and then inside this you can run exec to execute whatever program you want. Exec will override the address space, but it will not do anything with your resources like semaphores. Okay, this is one way that you can make sure that you get a fresh new semaphore that is not in use by any other process. The other possibility is you can use IPC create. So this, remember, is the in the key field. The other possibility is to use IPC create. This is in the flags part. What this tells the kernel is definitely create a new semaphore with the specified key value. So if you specify this and the kernel finds that a particular semaphore with that key ID already exists, then it will return an error. So then what you can do is something like you try the key value, maybe you increment it by 1 and you keep calling same get until it succeeds. Of course, then whatever key value IPC create succeeded on, that key value has to be communicated to the other processes that are making up your big application. So when the other processes call same get with whatever key value IPC create succeeded with, they will get back a copy of the existing. It's like doing an open on an existing file. They will get back the same semaphore. So either do IPC private followed by for, or keep trying with IPC create until it succeeds, and then make sure you have some mechanism of communicating that working key number to the other processes, so they can also call same get with the same key. Okay, so that's kind of for semaphore creation.
So that the implementation of the key, that is done by us
only? No, it will have to be, you will have to take care of. So you try IPC create, you get back -1, which will tell you that same get failed. So maybe you increment the key value, try again. Keep doing this until you succeed. In fact, you can actually check the error status. I think it is called key exists. Any other error code will mean that the semaphore failed for some other reason. But this is basically the error code for trying to create a semaphore with a key that already exists. Okay. So initialization turns out actually to be a little complicated, because instead of having a easy to use initialization function, you have a generic function called same CTL, which you use for all kinds of operations.
Sir, one question. Yeah. Sir, is there any possible application of this IPC create? We don't need to know the keys.
If you're using this, yeah, then you just get the same semIDs automatically thanks to the fork. But if you kind of have the processes created first and then they want to synchronize using a semaphore, then both of them have to use the same key in order to make sure that they're using the same semaphore for their synchronization. So one of them has to take care of creating it, and the other will have to make sure that it gets the same key value and it will call same get with that key value. So, of course, the second time around, it cannot use IPC create, because then it will get an error. Okay, so this we will postpone for a bit. This is again one interface for both weight and for signal. And this is kind of really complicated. Why I'm saying it's complicated is, remember, to start with, just like you have a file descriptor or file pointer, you have a semaphore ID. So in subsequent calls, you are going to use this to identify the semaphore, the set of semaphores. Remember, we can create an array of semaphores in one shot. So semop, basically what you can do is you can specify a large number of operations, any number of operations, all of which are going to be taken care of in that one system call. So these kind of set of operations that you want to do all together, you have basically a kind of a structure type that defines one semaphore operation. Then you have to create an array of such structures to specify the different operations you want to do. And when you call semaphore, you pass the semaphore ID that you want to work on, and you give it this array. Then in that one system call, it will do all the operations. So what does the operation look like? So this, it's called struct semaphore. You have, remember, semaphore is already sending the same ID. But same ID actually can correspond to an array of semaphores. So for each operation, you have to specify which element of the array you want to work on. So this unsigned short semaphore underscore number specifies the index of the semaphore within the set of semaphores identified by same ID. So this is any number between 0 to n sense minus 1. This is really a number that specifies whether you want to do a wait or a signal. Same flag we will ignore for now. So this is really, as I said, specifies wait or signal. So the possible values here are, notice that this is unsigned short, this is short. So here you can have positive, 0 or negative. Basically, positive means something like signal, it's non-blocking and the value just gets incremented, the semaphore value. 0 has a different meaning. 0 means wait for the semaphore value to be equal to 0. So if the semaphore value is not currently 0, then the process will block. Until, I mean, by some operation somewhere else, the semaphore value becomes equal to 0. Notice that we did not discuss any function like this. Wait and signal either increment or decrement. Here we also have wait until 0. And if semaphore op is less than 0, that is something like a wait. So whatever number you have given, say minus 3, it will try to decrement the semaphore value by 3. If this can actually be done, so you're checking for semaphore value is greater than the absolute value, say minus 3 you have given over here. So this has to be, I think basically I should check whether this is greater than or greater than equal to. I mean, the difference will be, if I pass minus 3 over here, does my semaphore value have to be 3 in order for me to proceed, or whether it has to be 4? I mean, this suggests 4, but that's a little kind of unintuitive. So anyway, this part I will check and confirm. So negative value you pass here, it will see if that negative value, or I mean, that number can be decremented from the current semaphore value. If it can, then you don't block, you proceed. Otherwise, the process blocks until this operation can actually be done. So, as I said, most cases, this will correspond to a signal, this will correspond to a wait. You can actually do something like a trilog, the trilog that we discussed earlier. Over here, in order to do a trilog, this flag over here, you can specify IPC no wait. If you specify IPC no wait, then it will not block, but it will tell you that the operation cannot be completed. So this is basically something like, it will return minus 1, and again the error code will tell you why it failed. So that error code can in this case tell you that you asked for no wait, but otherwise it would have blocked. So then you can try again after some time. One one important thing is what I said was semaphore, semaphore will actually work on multiple or can work on multiple semaphores and it can do multiple operations. So suppose you have asked for, I mean think of, okay, everybody remember the dining philosopher problem? Dining philosopher was what? Each philosopher has to pick up both the left fork and the right fork. One simple implementation that we saw that leads to deadlock is everybody picks up the left fork and they're all waiting for their right forks. So everything gets into a deadlock. Because you can now specify multiple operations in one go, you can actually say do a wait on both forks. And the good thing about the implementation is that it will either get both, or if it blocks on any one, it will not take the other and block on whatever it is not getting. It will either take nothing or it will do all operations. So using this, it turns out to be actually easy to write a non-deadlocking solution to the dining philosopher problem. You simply specify which forks you want within the same array of, what was it called, struct same buff. Specify both operations in a two-member array and give that set of two operations to semaphore. It will either get both forks or it will pick up neither. So this thing of kind of do the operations if all of them can succeed, otherwise don't do anything at all, just block the process. That makes it easy to write deadlock-free programs. The last general purpose function that we need is sensctl. And this is kind of, I mean, you can do different things like get the current value, set the current value, get all values into an array, set all values from an array. So this is like a one general purpose function for doing all kinds of miscellaneous operations. So if you wanted to initialize the semaphore value, then what you need to do is use a set value. Again, in practice, I think the best thing to do is to create the semaphore in the parent, initialize it within the parent, then fork so that the ready-made initialized semaphore gets shared across the children processes. Inside the children, then you do whatever exec you want. Actually, that's not easy either. You have to do something a little more complicated because remember, same ID you are storing somewhere. The moment you do exec, everything gets thrown away. So that same ID will also get thrown away. So you will actually have to save it somewhere, maybe in a file or something. So that even after exec, you can read the same ID from that file. So it's not that easy, but at least I think cleaner is, I mean, and surer way of doing this is to do the creation and initialization within a parent. Okay, how much time do we have? Okay, so I think in the remaining time we can quickly look at. Okay, so this is a kind of okay. Maybe it's worth discussing this example because it's so complicated. So this is what. Okay, in fact, I mean, so I should tell you all of this material is taken from advanced programming in the Unix environment and part of it from Unix network programming. And for your networks class, are you following Unix network programming? Okay, so then you are already familiar with the book. Same author has a different book called Advanced Programming in the Unix Environment that also has this synchronization related code. Okay, so here is a kind of, okay, normally what you would do is if you have have only one semaphore, and remember SemGate allows you to construct an array of semaphores, but if your array has only one element, then remember that the index is always going to be zero. Flag, mostly, we will not use at all, so this will also be zero. This, basically what I said was, this will be where. This is subject to mean that greater than being greater than equal to. So if it's a kind of straightforward critical section, and you can allow only one process at a time, so essentially it will be a lock unlock kind, then this kind of, you have your struct same buff, and basically you do one operation, which is this, on the only semaphore that is there in your array, do a minus one. Then when this is one, you can do the decrement and you will proceed. If it is already zero, then this cannot happen, so you will block. And this corresponds to the signal, again a one element array of operations to work on the only element in your array of semaphores. So we basically keep in mind that, I mean, that's basically why this is complicated. You have an array of semaphores to deal with, and every time you have to specify an array of operations. For simple cases, both arrays will have one element only. But you still have to keep in mind that they are arrays.
So could you repeat this thing again, that segment thing?
So, see, when you do a SemGate, initial value, you don't know what it is. So for us, mostly we've done shared semaphore, some S1 equal to 1. So that initialization you have to do. So to make sure that the initial value is 1, you have to call the SemCTL function. Specify which semaphore you want to work on, and specify the operation. The operation will be set well, and I mean, if you look at the details there, you can specify that the semaphore value should be set to 1. This is something you do at the beginning, before you start the part of your code where synchronization is necessary. So basically this is equivalent to, I mean, SemGet plus this SemCTL is something like, this part is SemGate, and this part is SemCTL. So usually this will work, but here's a different way of doing the same, this lock and unlock. Here's a different way of achieving the same objective. So your lock is actually an array of two operations. Remember, these are to be done together in one system call. Okay. Same number is zero always because we are dealing with only one semaphore. So lock is what? Wait for it to become zero. When it becomes, so this first operation is going to block if it is not zero. And then you increment it by one. So the convention here is that, normal convention that we have been following so far is 1 signifies free and 0 means block. This is actually the reverse convention. 0 means it's free, 1 means it's locked. So what this will do is, remember, these will get done together in one system call. That is equivalent to saying that both operations will be done atomically. Nothing else can happen in between. So the first operation will be block until the lock field is zero. When you find that it has become equal to zero, increase it to one to signify that it is locked, and carry on. When you are done, decrement it by one so that it will go back to being zero. So this is something like, actually if you notice, this is something like test and set. Wait until it is zero. Once it is zero, you set it to one atomically and then proceed. So this is exactly something like test and set. When you are done, you want to change it from one to zero. So you do this operation. Okay, so this is just kind of some simple code that makes use of this. So I won't go through this. POSIX semaphores are kind of much simpler. Of course, I mean, when you are actually writing code with this, make sure you consult the man pages. But they are very similar to the kind of the thread level synchronization functions that we looked at. They are very similar. All you do is, no need to do anything complicated like semget. Just declare something as semkey. Except because this is a variable declaration, the only way to share this is to have this done before the fork. There semget was, I mean, there was a semaphore key which you could use across processes, but because this is declared as a variable, you have to do this in the parent and then fork. Here too, as in the system 5 case, it can only have non-negative values, and you have much more kind of intuitive functions. Same init will directly set, I mean, you send a pointer to this, set the unsigned value that you want to set it, basically initialize. No need to go through a complicated same CTL type of general purpose function. Same way, this is absolutely like what we did in theory class. All wait and specify the semaphore. That is all you need to do. Likewise, as I said, I mean, same signal has other meanings. So you say same post, this is basically like a signal. Again, instead of having complicated things like same CTL, you have same init, you have same get value. So, I imagine you have a same set value too, but I don't know often. And you also have, I mean, when you're done, you can call the same destruct to remove all semaphores. So these are much kind of simpler to use, much more intuitive, much more close to the kind of code that we, pseudocode that we saw in the theoretical discussion. So, as I said, most of the time, this is what you will be using. If you are using an old system that does not give you POSIX semaphore, you have to use system 5. Okay, so that's all for today. Like I said, if you have time, look at the documentation before the lab. Otherwise, the first thing you do in the lab tomorrow is consult the documentation. And I'll send out a mail so that everybody knows what you're supposed to do. Basically, think of how you are going to do this multi-threaded file problem.